I'm Jonathan Neufeld. I'm here to introduce our speaker this morning, Eva Dalvez, who is a professor of humanities and philosophy at the University of Central Oklahoma. And she does, so I'm just going to steal from the little blurb that you had in the program, because I really like the fact that she works at the collision of aesthetics, ethics, and epistemology, and has published a couple of books, but I just wanted to say a couple, like read a couple of titles, because she has a talent for two-word titles, so I'm going to skip the post-colon part. So, four articles. One, Only Kidding, Truly Funny, Spectacularly Bad, and Pleased and Afflicted. Right? So, all really nice two-word titles that make you want to read the article. So, today's paper is Comedy and Tragedy, Two Sides of the Same Coin, so please help me welcome Eva Dalvez.
Hi, I'm really happy to be here. Thanks to Sheila Mucknall. Can you hear me okay?
Yes.
Okay, I use we throughout this article because I wrote this with someone who I met in Basel at a workshop on philosophy and literature, and who wrote his dissertation on Terry Pratchett. So who could resist working with someone like that, right? I'm basically reading you, most of the stuff I'm reading you, I wrote, so I'm in a position to answer the question. Okay, in Umberto Eco's classic novel, The Name of the Rose, we are introduced to a decidedly platonic fear of laughter. According to the blind librarian Jorge de Burgos, laughter is weakness, corruption, and the foolishness of the flesh. It is the peasant's entertainment, the drunkard's license. Laughter remains base. A defense for the simple, a mystery desecrated for the plebeians. Laughter could not accompany insight or clarity or revelation. By destroying the last known copy of the second part of Aristotle's Poetics, which delves into comedy after the already familiar investigation of tragedy, de Burgos hopes to undermine any argument that claims to find significance in comic content. Indeed, the central plot of The Name of the Rose hinges on Aristotle's Lost Book of Comedy and the relationship between laughter and institutional power in the late Middle Ages. Although Eco's account, and thereby de Burgos' antipathy, is fictional, comedy has undoubtedly remained the topic of controversy in both philosophy and literature. The argument against comedy is simple and sums up the humor-averse librarian's concerns perfectly. Addressing motifs of ridicule, comedy is itself ridiculous and can thus not be taken seriously. It cannot prove a source of insight as tragedy can. Thankfully, philosophical and other investigations into humor have challenged this reduction, underlining not simply the enjoyment afforded by comedy, but further emphasizing its role as an authentic counterpart of tragedy. Capable of generating equally important insights and capable of canvassing equally significant issues. This is the topic we wish to address. If comedy and tragedy are not opposites, but reciprocal poles of the poetic spectrum of narrative plots, then surely they may also draw on similar sources and achieve the effects they do via similar methods. Each, after all, is a mode of discourse or genre intended to elicit very specific emotions. Comedy, when successful, elicits amusement. Tragedy aspires to arouse pity and fear. We will argue that the two fulfill these distinct functions in surprisingly similar ways. Although discussions of incongruity are more typically found in various ventures into humor theory, our claim in this paper is that one of the decisive links between tragedy and comedy is their reliance on incongruity, that is, on phenomena and scenarios that violate established patterns or expectations. Incongruity theory is relevant to tragedy, of course, as any familiar with Aristotelian claims about reversal is sure to stress. However, its applicability, not just to serious matters, but to comic ones, has been maintained by several philosophers, and, you know, we've been hearing about this for a couple of days now. The approach we take in investigating these assumptions is twofold. First, we aim to underline the similarities between tragedy and comedy by investigating tragic and comic catharsis. Funny, as well as tragic content, often requires the representation of some deviation from a norm, some juxtaposition of incongruous elements. While comedies and tragedies arrive at different ends, depicting amusing and distressing outcomes, respectively, they nonetheless employ startlingly similar methods in depicting what it is they do and in eliciting the reaction suitable to their respective form. Starting with Plato's indictment of poetry in the Republic and Aristotle's milder concerns regarding the destabilizing force of humor and laughter, comedy and humor have been a recurrent, if underrepresented, issue in philosophical and literary studies. Aspects of comedy have always remained controversial for any of several reasons. Unsurprisingly, Plato does not approve of humor or intemperate laughter. For instance, he criticizes the laughter of the gods in the Iliad for being an emotion that overrides self-control, and comedy in general is a form of scorn. Aristotle expresses a considerably less strict view of laughter. He regards it as part of the ugly, a form of defect or deformity, which, however, is not harmful to anyone else, and which is thus acceptable within certain limits. More to the present point, the seeds of an incongruity approach to humor may be discovered in Aristotle's rhetoric, in which Aristotle dwells on enjoyable incongruities and the various skills required for their effective display, representation, or rendition. So here's a big chunk of quote. And the greatest number of elegant effects are the result of metaphor combined with misdirection. For it becomes more evident in what respect one learns something when it goes against a disposition toward its opposite, and that the soul seems to say, how true, and yet I missed it. In the case of quips, the elegant result not from meaning what one is saying, and the well-made riddles are pleasing for the same reason, for learning and metaphor are involved in what Theodorus calls speaking in innovative ways. This happens when something is paradoxical, but not, as he puts it, by our prior opinion, but like the turns of phrase and things that make us laugh, which jokes are capable of doing even by a turn in a letter, since it surprises us, and in poetic verses. So these are all clear references to standard examples of incongruity in humor, including explicit references to unexpectedness and irony. Furthermore, there's the Tractatus Coecilianarius, which I'm mispronouncing horribly, a fragment of a treatise on comedy assumed to be either a version or copy of a lost Aristotelian original, or an account stemming from familiarity with an Aristotelian work now lost to us. Sheila Lintott, who first made me aware of the existence of this document, points out that Richard Yanko has argued it consists of notes on Aristotle's lost writing on comedy. Lane Cooper maintains the most natural explanation is thus that the Poetics once included an explicit inquiry into the sources of comic effect, something analogous to, or possibly in essentials identical with, the analysis of the sources of laughter in the Tractatus Coecilianarius. The Britannica reports of this analysis that, accordingly as with tragedy, comedy must bring about a catharsis, but through the use of laughter and pleasure. Comic plots include ludicrous mishaps, deception, unexpected developments, and clumsy dances. Characters include imposters, self-deprecators, buffoons. While the language of comedy should be realistic, it may attain added comic force through the use of puns, dialogue, dialect, and word malformations. Once again, the reference is made to the unexpected and to hidden meanings and identities that are unanticipated, just as such elements are cited in the description of tragedy. This is at least somewhat promising for forging a link between humor and tragedy on purely Aristotelian grounds. In much later philosophical investigation, three major theoretical approaches to humor emerge. As you know, we canvassed these before, so I'll be really abbreviated. Superiority theory, incongruity theory, and relief theory. Superiority theory stems in part from Platonic and Aristotelian contentions that humor and amusement can center on feeling superior to others. Relief theory adopts a somewhat psychoanalytic approach, explaining humor as the release of repressed feelings and suggesting an interesting and tenuous connection with the Aristotelian account of catharsis as purgation. Incongruity theory, on the other hand, states that an essential ingredient of comic amusement is the juxtaposition of incongruous or contrasting objects, events, categories, propositions, maxims, and properties, and so on. Thank you, Noel. He is the one I'm quoting. In current humor research, incongruity theory may qualify as the leading approach, even though it should be admitted that none of the three theories is regarded as having provided us with a conclusive or comprehensive definition. Incongruous events violate expectations. We anticipate a certain outcome, and something entirely different happens. Consider a scene from the immortal A Fish Called Wanda, in which part of the story revolves around an animal rights activist forced into the role of assassin. This is the funniest thing in the world. I own it. I've watched it 20 times. The animal lover must eliminate a witness whose testimony in a trial will prove disastrous. The witness is a bad-tempered octogenarian who owns a flotilla of small, yapping dogs. One by one, each dog inadvertently falls a prey to the animal's lover assassination attempts, leaving the witness intact, much to the would-be assassin's distress and chagrin. He's an animal lover. He has pictures of baby seals on his wall. Every assassination attempt, death by Doberman, death by falling piano, takes the life of another dog instead of that of the owner. And what is funny isn't the death of the dogs, but the relentlessly repeated reversal of the incompetent assassin's carefully laid plans. In the end, the witness perishes from a heart attack consequent on dog deprivation, rather than as a result of the assassin's actions. Jokes rely on similar unforeseeable twists, and much of the joy and humor derives from not knowing how or when the surprise will come. There is the same kind of discontinuity between intended and actual outcomes as can be seen in tragic fiction. For all of it, this isn't an example that demonstrates a sort of cognitive investment in unraveling incongruity that certain comedies can exhibit. But before investigating the kind of perspective shifting and clarification that exploring incongruities can sometimes afford, let's focus on the basics. First, incongruity is a violation of what's regarded as normal, a term to which we attach all the caveats that should accompany generalizations of this kind. Despite any difficulties consequent on vagueness or generalization, it remains true that it's this violation of normed cultural patterns and expectations that's the driving force of incongruity theory, even though the characterization poses new problems with respect to imprecision. Second, approaches that associate humor with incongruity tend to ally amusement with a specific intentional object in the same way that fear, say, is aligned with some thought or belief about danger. Amusement targets a reversal or incongruity just as pity targets someone's suffering. But just as pity is most in evidence when the suffering in question is considered undeserved, so amusement is more likely when the reversal or incongruity is believed benign. That is, amusement is a response to a clash or dissonance that's regarded as, well, more or less harmless. As we shall see, the defeat of expectations can sometimes prove frightening and pitiable and tragic. Humor and comedy are associated more specifically with those incongruities that are typically thought less fit to be the intentional objects of fear or distress. John Morrell asks why we should permit the momentary disruption of clear trains of thought, let alone derive joy or amusement from the dissonant and disturbing. As we noted above, he observes that incongruity need not evoke positive or amused reactions, but can be found in tragedy as well. In fact, incongruity is a staple of tragic drama from the time of Aristotle, whose contention it was that reversal and recognition were key features of the tragic plot. Books 10 and 11 of the Poetics outline those desirable plot elements, focusing in particular on reversal in Book 11. So, and here's the Aristotle book. Reversal of the situation is the change by which the action veers round to its opposite, subject always to our rule of probability or necessity. Thus in the Oedipus, the messenger comes to cheer Oedipus and free him from his alarms about his mother, but by revealing who he is, he produces the opposite effect. Recognition, as the name indicates, is a change from ignorance to knowledge. The best form of recognition is coincident with the reversal of the situation, as in the Oedipus. Two parts, then, of the plot, reversal of the situation and recognition, turn upon surprises. So comedy and tragedy both rely on eliciting reactions to incongruity. and Aristotelian catharsis of pity and fear in the case of tragedy, and a response of amusement in the case of the comic. Both rely on recognition or discovery as well, the kind of realization that enables one to understand a tragic misapprehension or to get a joke. There is also a kind of perspective shifting involved in each case that may allow a further variety of clarification, something we'll take up presently. Moreau contends that the similarities between the tragic and comic end with their mutual trafficking and incongruities. In other respects, he maintains tragedy and comedy involve different and incompatible ways of evaluating one condition. We contest this latter point, since we believe that the comic and the tragic can on occasion give rise to quite similar insights, although our main concern will be to mine similarities between the two forms and suggest correspondences with which Morel might not be disposed to disagree. The pity and fear associated with tragic catharsis are said by Aristotle to be best produced by events which happen unexpectedly but on account of one another. And this can be taken, as per Stephen Halliwell, who is my go-to guy in Aristotle's Poetics, who's wonderful, he's got a great book, virtually as a definition of reversal. It is therefore telling that in Rhetoric 1, Aristotle singles out precisely sudden and unforeseeable reversals of fortune as a source of wonder. They both surprise us and arouse our minds to look for an underlying explanation of the ostensibly inexplicable. As elements of the tragic plot, reversal and recognition require that character, intention, and expectation come apart from the real-world consequences that character actions produce. The culmination of the complex tragic plot is the juncture at which ignorance becomes knowledge, and at which characters are confronted by the unintended and often least desired consequences of their choices. The reversal is a reversal of fortune, or a reversal from ignorance to knowledge, from expected to entirely unanticipated outcome. Aristotle's catharsis of pity and fear, something that ends, as he says, in wonder, has posed an interpretive challenge that continues to exercise philosophers. The so-called paradox of tragic pleasure, the problem of how works which elicit emotions like fear and pity may also arouse positive reactions for enjoyment, remains a subject of some interest. People appreciate tragic fiction, after all. And so our experience of it cannot be characterized as uniformly negative. One possible explanation may simply be that our pity and fear take different objects. We fear for and pity characters and are distressed by their circumstances, but we may enjoy the component of excitement of the dramatic tension and suspense aroused in us. The roller coaster theory, right? We may admire or be fascinated, both quite positive emotions, by characters, their traits, and their feats. And our admiration of their courage or fortitude may actually increase with the adversity which they are depicted as undergoing. We may respond aesthetically to the form of the work, to the beauty of the prose or the excellence of the acting, while being distressed by content. Also, and here's a feature that can be and often is shared by comedy, we may take satisfaction in any epistemic or moral improvements of which the work permits us to avail ourselves. We may, with respect to the latter, be happy to respond in the proper way, to the right thing, to the right extent, to exercise our moral dispositions. We may take satisfaction in even an unhappy insight afforded by a work, just because it is an insight and we're epistemically better off for having had it. We may derive satisfaction from our empathetic emotional responses and the way these may let us know what it is like to have certain experiences without having to pay the price of undergoing. Explanation seeking or explanation finding in response even to a fearful or distressing incongruity can be a kind of cognitive satisfaction in itself. As we see it, the principal difference between the tragic and the comic doesn't lie in our enjoying only one of them, since there's a clear sense in which we appreciate the contemplation of both. The difference lies in whether we take the deviation from expectation, the incongruity, to be harmful or harmless, dangerous or benign, amusing or distressing. Our interest is less in accurate unraveling of incongruities than in appreciator attitudes. So Pache Morel, methods employed by an appreciator of comedy and an appreciator of tragedy, respectively, in evaluating the incongruous, seem to have a lot in common. After being confronted by incongruity, one's next step appears to be a search for an explanation or resolution. In complex tragic drama, this may well involve an Aristotelian investment in the thought process of recognition and discovery, the revelation of the causal sequence that made the denouement inevitable, and along with that, some insight into a plight that puts one at the mercy of causal forces such as those. In comedy, the plot will be rife with violated expectations that will only amuse us if we grasp the resolution of the incongruities presented. In comic irony or satire, for instance, in which what is said is the opposite of what is meant, this will involve the recognition or discovery of the intended as opposed to the literal meaning. While, except sometimes it fails, as with Colbert, it depends. While not wishing to generalize, we might digress a bit by suggesting that comedy more often indulges, this is a speculation, but incongruities of form, whereas tragedy most often involves reversals and incongruities with respect to content. That is, comic effects are as often achieved by manipulating the way in which a given content is presented as they are by presenting us with an incongruous content, whereas this seems less typical of tragedy. So let me go back to a fish called manga. In regards to the form-content distinction, consider the scenario of dog devastation. A similar state of affairs could come across as tragic. I'm a dog owner. If the elderly woman's affection for her dogs were emphasized, or the dog's deaths were made slow, painful, and pathetic, maybe it would work. Indeed, when the movie was being filmed, some of those scenes were reshot just to make the dog's deaths appear less gruesome and realistic, because sample audiences got very upset. To keep the focus on the reversal of the assassin's plans and away from any depictions involving heart-rending loss or blood-spattered dog corpses. The film's ultimate depiction of the deceased canines was almost cartoonish. That is, steps are taken to depict the reversal as benign rather than tragic. But there might be more to the distinction than is at first apparent. The relentless repetition of assassination attempts, leading every one of them to the result an animal lover turned assassin would most wish to avoid. The repetition builds into a kind of comic crescendo that's amusing largely because the assassination attempt is made over and over and over again until every little bug is gone. The assassin's target finally dies as a kind of side effect of the culmination of the assassin's failures. A case could well be made that the humor hinges more on the repetition and its unforeseen and entirely unanticipated consequence. For this reason, it could be that a state of affairs taking that particular form, that is, retaining those specific repetitions and reversals, probably would not come across as entirely tragic. Whatever one concludes about the proceeding, however, it could still be argued that comparisons of tragedy and comedy are wasted. Efforts like ours on such a view might not take into account the triviality of comedy. I've gotten this from several people, relying as it does on jokes and slapstick. Such objections would maintain that comedy seldom lends itself to insight or profundity, despite the reversals and incongruities at its heart. So it could follow that the claim that comedy is like tragedy and its provision of insights is a gross overestimation of the effects of incongruities on the dramatic audience. Fortunately, there's a simple response to this objection. Unless one begs the question by restricting the category of tragedy to high art alone and relegating all other contenders to less exalted genres such as melodrama, there are plenty of examples equally lacking in profundity and high-mindedness to be found among works that could be held to aspire to the tragic. For every Adam Sandler movie, there's a saccharine tearjerker, a cinematic veneration of patriotism. each roughly constructed like a classic tragedy, but plagued by a tendency to give rise to false insights and encourage unreflective assumptions. These are arguably worse than comedies, in that they expect to be taken seriously and lend a cachet to the alleged insights on offer in a way that comedies do not. There are at minimum two ways in which tragedies and comedies we can regard as more or less devoid of profundity could resemble one another. First, they could be trivial in the sense of appealing to the lowest common denominator. Such works need not be bad, of course, or even shallow, though they may be. Their triviality may consist, as Mark Silcox has suggested, in their small stakes. They might reinforce insights we already have, but wouldn't produce new ones. Alternatively, they could give rise to ethical objections and concerns. But let's begin with the trivial or sentimental, using the latter term in its pejorative sense. A lot of comedy is trivial. Plots from romantic comedies are virtually interchangeable. Popular humor often results to material that's been good for getting a laugh since fifth grade. Relying on scatological references, slapstick, sexual innuendo, and fart jokes. Much of this is really an appeal to a still active and still accessible juvenile sensibility. And it goes without saying that popular comedy falls into this category more often than not. But tragic stories, too, can appeal to the lowest common denominator in the form of tearjerkers like Love Story or Titanic, in which Aristotelian reversals principally involve doomed love. Gone with the Wind, while it dwells on the reversal of affections, is similarly dependent on a combination of spectacle, highly sentimentalized conceptions of romance, and floridly melodramatic depictions of longing and heartbreak. Arguably, almost every soap opera in existence could provide excellent examples of the kind of low-stakes triviality under consideration. The central subplot of George R. R. Martin's wildly popular Game of Thrones, to which I must admit I am addicted, turns on a classic reversal in which the story's apparent protagonist, Ned Stark, is unexpectedly executed, and in which this happens in an almost direct consequence of his attempts to follow what he believes to be the moral course and of his attempts to avoid that very execution. Such dramas take things that are always and invariably sad, invest them with beautiful protagonists and memorable special effects, and pull on our heartstrings for all they are worth, laboring to depict tear-soaked countenances in order to invite emotional contagion, and often literally resorting to the plaintive wail of violin strings. There is nothing wrong with that on that account, of course, though we do believe that over-reliance on spectacle can signal directorial laziness, and that a whole separate set of ethical questions can be raised about one of the main. However, it does seem clear that such works will not yield important insights about human nature. And far more respectable examples can be supplied. Theater historian Neil Hebert suggests we consider Neil LaBute's The Shape of Things and Fat Pig. These are both excellent plays, which have been nominated for or won major awards. They perform well with contemporary audiences, but he maintains they appear to be much deeper than they actually are. The Shape of Things teaches us that artists aren't beyond morality by virtue of their status as creators. While Fat Pig teaches us that fat people have feelings and deserve happiness too. They may help to reinforce some convictions we already possess, but additional insights are in relatively short supply. Another way in which humor might be thought antithetical to insight concerns what Ronald D'Souza has referred to as chronic mirth. Humor can be cruel or hostile. It might, as D'Souza and others have suggested, sometimes actually depend on the possession of immoral attitudes, as when finding a rape joke funny depends on regarding rape as an alternative form of sexual intercourse, or believing that promiscuity signals a kind of blanket consent to anything, anywhere, anytime. Jokes of this kind typically turn on the incongruity of an undesirable desideratum. And the explanation and resolution of the puzzle is thought to hinge on possession of the morally dubious belief or attitude, i.e. that it's actually desired. Humor can also foster bonding, yet can do so by means of social exclusion, and by reinforcing the perception of stereotypical differences. The dark aspect of humor is familiar to us all. And while that darkness doesn't at all, and I want to stress this, prevent humor from being insightful, for hostility or disapproval may be appropriate attitudes in certain contexts, it is clear that some forms of humor are at least morally questionable because they depend on or reinforce beliefs and attitudes we regard as problematic. However, tragedy can give rise to similar differences. Just as mockery and derision may be more or less appropriate, so may admiration and approval of someone cast as a tragic hero. Consider the film American Sniper. Loosely based on Chris Kyle's memoir about being a sniper during the Iraq occupation, the film gave rise to as many questions about credibility as the book. In the words of Matt Taibbi, reviewing for Rolling Stone, to turn the Iraq War into a saccharine, almost PG-rated, two-hour cinematic diversion about a killing machine with a heart of gold, is there any film theme more perfectly 2015 America than that, who slowly, very slowly, starts to feel bad after shooting enough women and children? Gump notwithstanding, that was a hard one to see coming. The film ends as Kyle's life ended with a classic Aristotelian reversal. Kyle, unable to adjust fully to civilian life after four tours of duty as a sniper in Iraq, is advised to help other wounded and traumatized veterans. In 2013, he was killed by one such veteran whom he had arranged to meet at a shooting range. The ironies are powerful, and the film gains impact from them. But apart from questions about what the definition of heroism was exactly to which we were asked to subscribe, there are further concerns about the purposeful focus on a single glorified individual. For Taibbi, the really dangerous part of this film is that it turns into a referendum on the character of a single soldier. It's an unwinnable argument in either direction. We end up talking about Chris Kyle and his dilemmas, and not about the Rumsfelds and Cheneys and other officials up the chain who put Kyle and his high-powered rifle on rooftops in Iraq and asked